All right, I think we can start. Welcome everyone to our first seminar of the summer series. Today, seminar speaker is Dr. Maya Dupuy. She is virtually visiting us from San Jose State University, where she is an assistant professor in the Department of Biological Sciences. Her lab integrates tools in animal behavior, biomechanics, stable isotope ecology, and engineering to understand how individual morphology contributes to ecosystem dynamics, primarily trophic interactions and how these interactions may shift with climate change. Dr. Maya Devrat did a PhD in integrative biology at the University of California, Berkeley, and then she was a postdoctoral fellow at Scripps. Before joining San Jose State University, she was a proud member of the CMSI in her position as the National Research Friendship Coordinator for Sustainable Oceans. And today she's going to talk about trophic relationships in the benthos, feeding morphology, and ecology of macroinvertebrates. Before we start, a reminder on how the seminar is going to go. Maya will give the talk, and if you have questions, please type them into the chat box that is at the bottom of the screen. After the talk, I will read the questions to Maya, and please keep your camera and microphones off. The seminar of next week will be by Dr. Lauren Siebelhardt, a project scientist at UC Merced and postdoctoral researcher at UC Davis, and the title is going to be Beyond the Snapshot, What Can We Learn from Capturing the Broader Picture Around Perturbation Events in Marine Invertebrates. With that, I would like to hand it over to Maya, and I hope you enjoy the seminar.
Great, thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you all for having me. It's such an honor to get to speak to you all at the Dega Marine Lab. What Aurora didn't mention is I also did my undergrad at UC Davis. And so I am just so thrilled to get to share my research with you. I think you'll see a lot of themes throughout my talk that were inspired by and very influenced by my time at Davis. And then I was so lucky to get to spend a year there as part of Sustainable Oceans, which also has influenced my work even for the short time I was there. So really looking forward to talking with you all today. So I'd like to start by describing a little bit of this photograph that you see here on the first slide. And so here you see a spearing mantis shrimp lunging out of its burrow to capture this evasive fish prey. And so it has spear-like appendages, long appendages with many spines on it that it uses to capture this damselfish. And so these specialized modifications help it to capture this evasive fish prey. And this animal is in the process of doing something that all animals have to do, and that is consuming food resources. So this trophic interaction demonstrates the fundamental need to feed. And that is important. It's a really important factor shaping the amazing global biodiversity that we see in the world. And it is for these reasons that my research is broadly interested in the relationship between feeding morphology and feeding ecology and how that relates to broader trophic dynamics in an ecosystem. A little bit about stomatopod crustaceans or mantis shrimp. They're an incredibly diverse group. I learned early in my graduate school career that they are an excellent system for understanding the relationship between feeding morphology and feeding ecology because they have these specialized structures, which we'll talk more about in a little bit. And we thought we knew a lot about them in terms of their ecology, but we learned that these animals are actually quite surprising in their ecology and the ways that they influence their environment. But these animals are one of many in the huge coral reef in which they live. Many of the species of stomatopods live in a coral reef environment. And you wouldn't know it from looking at this picture, but the reef has millions of species. It occupies less than 1% of the sea floor, but coral reefs are home to more than 25% of all marine life. And all of these organisms are, of course, interacting with one another and their environment, and they're consuming food resources. Additionally, they are all living in an environment that's rapidly changing. Reefs themselves are, of course, undergoing unprecedented changes. And given the importance of many organisms to an ecosystem, and particularly coral reefs, my perspective is that we can't understand ecosystem function without understanding and having a deeper knowledge of morphology on the individual level. And of course, thinking about feeding interactions between organisms and how this relates to broader trophic dynamics. And so today we're going to explore these ideas, specifically in mantis shrimp, but then we're going to broaden this to a reef-wide scale, and then we're also going to think about this in different habitats as I've expanded my research beyond reefs recently. So on a fundamental level, I'm really interested in how animals capture food, how these interactions fit into trophic dynamics, and how these feeding strategies may shift under future ocean conditions. And so these topics guide the two main questions of my work, which is how do morphological feeding specializations contribute to trophic dynamics and ecosystem function? And how do environmental disturbances influence trophic relationships? I just had to share this amazing creature with you all. So this is a largemouth bass. This is not a tropical coral reef species, but it is a temperate freshwater predator. And I started working on this animal in Dr. Peter Wainwright's lab as an undergrad. And we were looking at how acute temperature changes may influence the ability of largemouth bass to create the amazing suction feeding strikes that they do in order to capture prey. And so this work, and really all my time at UC Davis, was really like foundational to the rest of my career and where I am today. So you can see that this question was really rooted in the current interests and of where I am today. So had to give a plug for the freshwater largemouth bass. And again, these questions are rooted in these really classic questions of functional morphology and ecology that I know the UC Davis community thinks a lot about. And so we generally think that morphological specialization narrows diet. Here we have the proboscis of the hawk moth that precisely fits into the columbine nectar spur. Another great example is the jaw of the egg-eating snake that can expand to at least twice the width of its head in order to engulf an egg. All of these have become really classic examples for how we understand the relationship between diet and morphology. And so we think we can look at a feeding structure and kind of hypothesize what animals are eating, and I'm really interested to know how general that really is. Another classic example are the beaks of the Galapagos finches or Darwin's finches. Of course, they have beaks that are highly modified to either crush small seeds or large seeds, eat from cactuses or insects from trees, like the woodpecker finch down here. And what we've learned from the large body of work on Galapagos finches is that environment is a really key component for this understanding this relationship between morphology and ecology as well. And so environment can really drive ecological changes. Really seminal work on this was done by Peter and Rosemary Grant, of course, in this is a study from the late 70s. They had been taking data on the distribution of beak sizes in the small and medium ground finches and the large ground finches. And they looked, and then there was a terrible drought in kind of the late 70s, and they looked at the distribution of beaches, of beaks before and after the drought. And so you can see a shift in the distribution of beak sizes to larger beak sizes after the drought, because there were only large seeds left. All of the smaller and medium sized seeds had already been consumed. And so really the animals that had the large beaks, like the large ground finches, were able to take advantage of the resources available. And so these beak sizes change, the distribution of beak sizes changed over two seasons, which is really incredible. And it just shows you the power of the environment to shift the diet morphology relationship and the kind of the morphology that you see in the ecosystem. But then of course, this also, the finches consuming the seeds also influenced the environment and the availability of food resources. And so again, stomatopod crustaceans or mantis shrimp are a really great example of how we can understand the diet morphology relationship. They have become famous for their amazing vision. I'm sure you've all heard they have the best eyes in the animal kingdom, best reported eyes. They also have these amazing raptorial appendages, like what you see here. And they've become pretty famous in popular media. So here's a cartoon from The Oatmeal. If you haven't seen it yet, I highly recommend that you look it up. Just Google The Oatmeal and mantis shrimp. And it's a pretty entertaining comic on mantis shrimp and their amazing capabilities. But here you see a mantis shrimp using its raptorial appendage or its predatory appendage to smash the claw off of this crab. And I actually have a video of just this. This might take a second to load here. There it is. Okay. So here, this is a high-speed video filmed at 3,000 frames per second, slowed down so that you can see what's happening. But you'll see this hammer-like appendage here rotate forward and smash the claw off of this crab. So the claw goes flying across the tank. Now that it's buffered a bit, it might play a little bit better. The claw flies across the tank, and you're actually witnessing one of the fastest movements ever reported in the animal kingdom. This appendage is moving at about 50 miles per hour, accelerations that are comparable to a 22 caliber bullet, and it generates forces that are thousands of times the body weight of the animal. So really impressive. Okay, but this cartoon that I showed you before is actually illustrative of a really important feeding interaction. And so here you see the morphology that's doing the punching of the crab. And of course, then we see the broader feeding interaction. And so this is a kind of typical predator-prey dynamics that you see with mantis shrimp. And this interaction cannot occur without the feeding morphology. So at a very basic level, feeding morphology is driving this feeding interaction. But this interaction is, of course, really small. And so we have to scale it down so that we can understand how it's really working in nature. And so this feeding interaction is, of course, part of the larger trophic ecology of the ecosystem. Mantis shrimp are consuming many different prey, and then there are predators that are consuming the mantis shrimp. And all of these interactions coexist in an environment as well, in a common environment. And so again, the environment is, of course, critical for governing the diet morphology relationship. And in this context of the coral reef, we have to consider things like nutrient influx, seasonal changes in oceanographic conditions, and of course, we now have to really start to think about future changes on a large scale, such as ocean acidification and warming, and how that can influence these diet morphology relationships. And so, again, it's my perspective that we can't understand ecological function holistically without a deeper morphology of understanding of morphology on the individual level and feeding interactions between organisms and how that relates to trophic dynamics on an ecosystem level. So if we focus first on this question of feeding interactions, we can look at the morphology in a little bit more detail when we think about stomatopods. So typically all of that amazing diversity that I showed you earlier can be broken down into two functional groups. So we have spears that have these hammer-like appendages, kind of this big bulb at the base of their dactyl that they use, I think, typically to hammer hard-shelled prey. And then we have these spears. So this is the same spear that you saw in that very first photo. They have these really elongated appendages, very streamlined, with many spines to help them capture things from the water column. So to talk a little bit more about the smasher, this is a video of a peacock mantis shrimp smashing a snail in real time. So you can get a sense of what it looks like. It's the back appendage, so you can't fully see what's going on. So let's slow this down a bit. Here is another high-speed video, filmed at 5,000 frames per second, but slowed down to 15 so you can see it. And you'll see this hammer-like appendage rotate forward and smash the snail. And you'll see two flashes of light, one upon impact and one about 11 seconds later. That happens right about here. So basically what's happening with those flashes of light, there's the first one and then the second's going to happen right here. That's cavitation. So there it is. Basically the appendage is moving so fast through water that it creates an area of low pressure. When that, and that creates an air bubble. When that air bubble implodes, it releases energy in the form of light and heat that's comparable to the sun, which is really amazing. And that's cavitation. And actually the initial impact of the strike is really important for starting to break the shell, but the cavitation also, the implosion of the cavitation bubble also produces forceful impact that helps to crack the shell as well. So it's really pretty amazing. I like to think of an analogy where if a mantis shrimp were human size and if it were to throw a baseball with the same kinematics that it's using now, it would actually launch that baseball into orbit around the Earth. So pretty crazy. Let's compare that to the spear. So this is the spearing mantis shrimp in real time. It lunges out of its burrow again, and it's actually capturing a piece of freeze-dried shrimp on a stick. So let's slow this movement down. So you'll see the mantis shrimp open its appendages. So it actually opens that dactyl part, which is different from the spear, the smasher, and then it will grab the shrimp prey on a stick there. And so there it's opening its appendage and it's going to rotate them forward to capture that spearing, to capture that shrimp prey. You can see that the speeds of this strike are about 10 times slower than that of the smasher. The linear accelerations are like pathetically slower. So it's much slower than the smasher. But actually, when you look at these values and you compare them to other animals that consume evasive prey, they're right, kind of very similar kinematics. So the durations are similar to a fish opening its jaw, for example. In fact, largemouth bass opening its jaw. And the speeds are similar to like a squid protracting its arms in order to capture prey. So the difference here, of course, is that this is a much different behavior. They're opening their appendages, that creates different drag dynamics on the system. They're capturing much different prey. They really need to be able to reach far in order to be able to capture anything. And so they also just need to be faster than their prey. They don't need to be fast to create high forces, which is what spears have to do. They really just need to be faster than their prey. And so again, if we look at these the spear and the smasher side by side, we see the smasher is much faster and more powerful, but that's because they're doing different things. And morphologically, there are reasons for this as well. So all mantis shrimp appendages can function like a spring. Basically, here we have the mantis shrimp and its appendage. Then we have two schematics, one with the appendage loaded and one with it released. So basically, all of the exoskeleton elements in the appendage are functioning, at least in this part of the appendage, are functioning as a spring. And so this dotted line here on the loaded schematic is a muscle. And so when that extensor muscle contracts, it actually loads the spring. So it's really just like you are compressing a slinky. And then there's a little latch mechanism, which you can't see here, but that holds this other part of the appendage in place. When that latch releases, then the spring elements release and the appendage can fly forward. And you can think of it actually as bending a ruler. When you release the ruler, obviously the ruler bounces back in a much faster time frame than when you compressed it. And what we think is happening with differences between the spear and the smasher is that the spear actually, when they get too large, they can't operate their spring anymore. So we think there's a scaling component. And a lot of this work was done by my PhD advisor, Sheila Paddock. But we also figured out that the small mantis shrimp do have the spring-loaded strike, but the larger ones don't. So that was kind of the indicator for the scaling question. Okay, so now that we understand a little bit more about the morphology, we can start to think about what does this mean in the ecology of the ecosystem? What does that mean these animals can or cannot consume? What does that mean for where they live and that kind of thing? So to summarize, I told you that smashers are super fast and powerful. We also, there was a long-standing hypothesis that they mostly ate hard-shelled prey. But this was all based on anecdotal observations, so we really don't know much about what they eat. But they are mostly found in these hard substrate habitats like coral rubble or coral reef habitats. Spears, on the other hand, are very fast, but they're also far-reaching. They need to be able to reach far in order to capture prey. They mostly eat soft-bodied and invasive prey, and they mostly live in these soft substrate habitats. So hopefully I've convinced you now that the smashing mantis shrimp has really specialized morphology that allows it to create really impressive speeds and accelerations. And again, the question is, does that lead to a narrow diet of mostly hard-shelled prey or a wide diet where it allows them to consume prey that they wouldn't otherwise be able to? And again, most of what we know about diet is based on anecdotal observations. We also know from abundance studies done in the 80s that they can influence the distribution and abundance of snails and hermit crabs, so hard-shelled prey. So they're probably consuming a lot of them. But you'd think with impressive kinematics like that, would your diet really be narrow, or could you consume these other prey? So in order to figure that out, we needed to figure out what mantis shrimp actually eat. We didn't know what mantis shrimp ate, and we needed to know if they have a varied diet. And it turns out that a simple question is not easy to answer. This is part of my PhD work. I combined an abundance study and a feeding experiment and a stable isotope analysis of diet to figure out what mantis shrimp are eating, because you can't just look in their stomach to see what they're eating. So I looked at this particular species. This is Neogonodactylus bredeni, or the Caribbean rock mantis shrimp. Its maximum length is about 50-60 millimeters, so about 2 inches. You can see that they're small, but they're pretty powerful smashers. Here is a video of the mantis shrimp smashing the apex off of this snail. And you find them in these intertidal reef flat habitats in the Caribbean. And my main study site was the Goleta Marine Laboratory at the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama. Just to give you some context of where we are, this is the Caribbean side of the Panama Canal. If you were to turn around from this spot and walk about 3 miles, you would actually get to the entrance, the Caribbean entrance to the Panama Canal. So we're very close. The Panama Canal. What's really neat about this field site is it had more mantis shrimp than I've ever seen in one place at one time. But also it had these kind of repeating habitats of seagrass next to coral rubble. And so we had replicate plots for looking at diet across these two different habitat types in mantis shrimp. So we could really understand how varied their diet is in these two habitats where they live. So to begin to understand diet in a diverse place like a coral reef, even a reef flat, We started by looking at all of the potential prey that manta shrimp could possibly be eating. So we did an abundance study of all of the prey, all of the organisms that were less than twice the size of a manta shrimp. And this was my intern at the time, my STRI intern, Lovely Albayar, who is now a PhD student in Japan, which is pretty cool. And so we looked at the abundance of all these different prey, and then these are the most abundant potential prey items that we found in the habitat. And we thought, okay, so let's figure out if manta shrimp can possibly eat these different prey items. Because again, we didn't really know what they were capable of consuming. So we wanted to know, what are they able to eat in the lab to kind of narrow down what they possibly could be consuming. So we fed one manta shrimp each one of these prey. So we had one manta shrimp and one prey item in a tank, and we would wait to see if the manta shrimp would eat it. And then we would have another manta shrimp in another tank with another prey item. And we did those trials 10 times for each of these different prey. So here we have the results of that kind of simple experiment just to figure out what are they capable of eating. So we have all the prey items here and the number of trials out of 10 in which prey were consumed. And I think the takeaway here is that when given the opportunity, manta shrimp will consistently consume soft-bodied prey. So their morphology is not limiting them to a diet of only hard-shelled prey. They are capable of consuming soft-bodied and invasive prey. And we actually also have observations of them capturing prey using that more spearing type strike in order to capture the prey, which is really interesting. I should also mention that brittle stars and alpheids are in this soft-bodied and or evasive prey category because after observations, we found out that they really, manta shrimp capture these prey in a very similar way than they do like a worm or a sardine or a fish, really. We use sardines, but any fish. And so with these hard-shell prey items, it takes them multiple strikes in order to get to the flesh. But with an alpheid, they can capture it, and then they can use their maxillipeds to get to the meat. So that's why they're in this category. Okay, so now we had an idea of what they're eating in the lab, what they're capable of eating. Now we wanted to know, what are they eating in the field? And so in order to do this, we really needed a complete picture of diet breadth over space and time. And I'm sure you all know that stable isotope analysis is a really great way to be able to understand diet breadth over space and time. When you think about stable isotopes, they are, of course, you can think about the predator as a mixture of all of the different stable isotopes of the prey. So you can look at predator muscle tissue, and you can get an idea of what they're eating. Because they have integrated the kind of stable isotope values of their predator, because all organisms have stable isotopes, and we can use this to understand who eats whom in an ecosystem, which is really neat. I particularly focused on nitrogen 15 and carbon 13. We have to think about discrimination factors, which is this kind of standard difference between predator and prey stable isotope values when we think about stable isotopes. Traditionally, or I guess usually, you see that there isn't much discrimination between stable isotope values with carbon. With carbon, you generally are what you eat. But with nitrogen, we like to say you are what you eat plus 3 parts per mil. So there's this trophic kind of difference that happens. It's about 3 parts per mil as you go up the food chain. And so we performed with other undergrads at the time, a stable isotope analysis of diet. So this was my undergrad at Berkeley, Julia Hassan, helping to dissect all the manta shrimp and prey items that we looked at. We just looked at these focal prey species. And then we actually also did an experiment to get experimentally derived discrimination factors. For those of you who are interested, we actually, manta shrimp found the opposite of what you would expect. So carbon, we actually had a discrimination factor of 3 parts per mil, and nitrogen, we had a discrimination factor of 1. So it was really good that we did this experiment. And this was with my undergrad at the time, Samantha Liu. And so we can graph all of the carbon values on the x-axis and all the nitrogen values on the y-axis. And so here we see in yellow, we have all of the coral rubble mantis shrimp that we analyzed. So, and then here we have in blue, we have all the seagrass mantis shrimp that we analyzed. And then in both graphs, you see the mean and the standard deviation values for the prey items, and the dashed lines are soft body prey and the solid lines are hard shell prey. I think the thing to notice here is you can kind of, when you graph the stable isotope values like this, you can kind of see and make predictions about what mantis shrimp are eating. So in both habitats, they all kind of seem to cluster around this snapping shrimp, worm, clam, fish area. I should also mention really quickly that I did combine alpheids or snapping shrimp and worms because they were isotopically very similar and also functionally consumed in a pretty similar way. So you'll see snapping shrimp is the representative of snapping shrimp and worms. But of course, we want to know if what we're kind of seeing here, if that means anything statistically, if that can tell us anything about diet statistically. So we can use these mixing model analyses of diet. Again, you can think about a predator as a mixture of all the different prey items. And so we can use this mixing model theory and we can combine that with Bayesian statistics to get an idea about what mantis shrimp are actually consuming. And so I did this with the help of Brian Stock, who was a grad student at Scripps Oceanography, and now he's a postdoc at NOAA and Northwest Fishery. And really neat because I had prior information about my system, I was able to put that into the model. And so that's really a neat thing about Bayesian statistics, as I'm sure a lot of you know, is you can use your prior knowledge to inform your model. And so we used two priors. The first was a hard-shelled prey prior, because from the literature, we kind of have this idea that mantis shrimp are specialists in hard-shelled prey. So let's see what happens when we force a mantis shrimp to be a hard-shelled prey specialist or a hard, in the model. And so we gave hard-shelled prey 4 times the weight of soft-bodied prey. We also used the prey abundance data. And it's a little bit hard to see here, but basically there were way more snails and hermit crabs from my abundance data than there were soft body prey. So the hard shell prey distribution is actually all the way over here, and the soft bodied prey distribution is here. And so again, we're kind of forcing everything to the hard shell prey side, but that's from data, from actual data, which is pretty neat. And then we compared that to what we call the generalist prior. So oftentimes with these studies, there's no prior information. So a lot of people use generalist priors and they give what we call the generalist prior, which means no information, all prey are given equal weights. And that's kind of the standard method. So I'll show you the results from all of these priors. The first is the generalist prior. I think the thing you probably notice is, oh, so here we have prey on the x-axis and the median proportion of the diet of all the different prey on the y from the model. And I think the thing that probably jumps out is that mantis shrimp are eating a lot of clams, but they're also eating a lot of fish. So that's pretty interesting and not what we had expected for an animal that was considered to be a specialist in hard-shelled prey. The information priors supported the generalist prior. So again, clams seem to be important in the diet, but so does fish. And so that was pretty consistent, which is really neat. And I think that mantis shrimp are consuming a lot of clams because they live in these coral rubble cavities, both in coral rubble and in seagrass. And the clams happen to live on those rubble pieces as well, generally underneath. And so mantis shrimp can probably pretty easily leave their cavities, grab some clams, and then go back to their cavities. And I think this might be similar for fish as well, where they can capture fish outside of their cavities pretty easily. Also, of course, fish are very proteinaceous, so it's would be an important component of their diet as well. So that's why I think those two prey items are probably important. because they're just accessible. And one thing that I should mention is that space is highly limited in this coral reef environment. It's really hard to get a cavity. Mantis shrimp are consistently competing for them. So to be able to keep your coral cavity is advantageous. So to summarize this portion, I think we learned that specialized feeding morphology broadens the diet of a smasher. And we also learned that a smasher can be a generalist coral reef predator that consumes a wide diversity of prey. It seems to consume, perhaps include all of those prey in its diet, even though we see it consuming a lot of fish and a lot of clams, which are of course functionally very different too. So it's pretty interesting to think about how morphology has actually broadened their diet. So now we understand what a mantis shrimp is doing to its prey items potentially in the ecosystem. What happens when we compare it with a spear? How does that change the dynamics? So this is another field site where I've worked. This is the Gump South Pacific Research Station at UC Berkeley. Well, it's not at UC Berkeley, it's in Moorea, French Polynesia, but it's run by UC Berkeley. And this is my field site here. If you were to put on a mask and go for a snorkel, you would see a lot of coral heads that look like this. And then you'd also see a lot of coral rubble pieces down here. And that is where a couple of really neat mantis shrimp live. So in the same habitat, we have this smasher, Gonodactylus childi, and the spear, Rallocerania morea. And this is really neat because this is one of the few places in the world where you see a spear and smasher living in the same habitat. So we can start to look at diet differences while kind of controlling for habitat in this natural experiment. I should also say that these are both pretty small mantis shrimp. They're about half the size of the ones we were looking at before. Again, you know, here's kind of the typical smashing morphology, typical spearing morphology. So I collected mantis shrimp and the prey, potential prey from this habitat as well. And I also looked at plankton this time to add to the prey that they were the possible prey items. And I ran the same analysis. So here this time we see spears in yellow and smashers in blue. Again, we have all the prey on the x-axis and median proportion of the diet on the y-axis. Because I did not take abundance data here, I kind of verified the model by running it with two different discrimination factors. So I ran it with the experimentally derived ones for mantis shrimp, but I also ran it with the average values from the literature, which remember are opposite from each other. But when I did this, I actually did get similar results. So that was really great. And again, in both cases, it seems like clams are an important part of the diet, but interestingly for smashers, but when you look at spears, fish are an important part of the diet. So here, I think we see a really nice example of competition for soft body prey, kind of forcing the smasher to consume hard shell prey. So potentially this could be an explanation for the evolution of smashing, that these animals were kind of forced to consume hard shell prey to alleviate competition for soft body prey. That is, I think, what is happening now in the present. Be really interesting to look at this in an evolutionary phylogenetic context, and that's something that I would love to do down the road. Also, I really want to understand more about the potential role of competition in kind of forming the diet of a smashing mantis shrimp. Because I think what we learn when we pair a spear and a smasher together in a habitat is that we see that they both can consume a diversity of prey regardless of their morphology. But the morphological specialization really allows the species to consume otherwise inaccessible prey. So the smasher is able to take advantage of hard-shelled prey while the spear is outcompeting them for soft-bodied prey. And the diets of these species are likely a result of consistent competition for prey, which I think is really interesting. So now we understand a little bit more about feeding interactions and these broader trophic dynamics. what happens when we put this into an environmental context and start to think about how environments can be influencing this diet morphology relationship. So again, I told you I'm really interested in how future ocean conditions can affect these this diet morphology relationship. I don't need to tell this group at Bodega that ocean acidification is affecting calcified structures. So we see everything from foraminifera to gastropods and corals experiencing dissolution and kind of inability to create and build the same calcified structures in an acidified environment. But with crustaceans, we see kind of different responses. And when I did this work, this is part of my postdoc, there was very little literature on ocean acidification effects on crustaceans. But generally what we saw was no response, a neutral response, or a situation where the calcified structures were actually becoming more heavily calcified. And that's probably because of the differences in the way that crustaceans also regulate, or often they use the bicarbonate ion to create their exoskeletons. But we were really interested about what that would mean for mantis shrimp, because mantis shrimp, as I told you at the beginning, are really dependent on their exoskeleton to be able to produce these powerful strikes that are so key for their ecology. So we looked at how morphology might change in response to pH and temperature, because of course temperature is a really important component of climate change as well. So obviously sea surface temperatures are increasing, and so we can look at this multi-stressor effect to understand how organisms might respond. And so again, we know that the exoskeleton behaves like a spring. If you have a more calcified spring, that would make your spring stiffer. And like we talked about at the beginning, that would really affect the ability to produce these powerful strikes. So we really wanted to know how the appendage was going to respond to future ocean conditions. And so this was an experiment I did at Scripps Institution of Oceanography with someone who probably looks very familiar to a lot of you. Vicky Morgan was our lab manager at the time. And so she spent a lot of time in this room, as did my other my undergraduate at the time, Grace Chan. We were looking at these mantis shrimp. So we had 72 mantis shrimp in these little cups here. And then we had an ambient treatment, a low pH treatment, a low pH high temperature treatment. And we're using pH 7.8, so kind of a near future scenario. And so we ran this we looked at individuals at 3 months and also at 6 months to have kind of a medium term and a longer term idea of how mantis shrimp were responding to OA and temperature. And so we specifically looked at exoskeleton structure and mineral composition of the dactyl, which is the smashing surface of the appendage. And we looked at the meris too, which is where all of the spring elements are for the system. And we compared the meris in particular to the carapace, because we thought the carapace was kind of like a generalized structure. It's mostly used for protection, just like most exoskeleton is. It doesn't have these same kind of exoskeleton elements like the meris does. And so when we look at mineral composition, we used scanning electron microscopy and electron dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, EDX, to be able to get the percent composition of all the different elements in the appendage and in the the other exoskeleton components in cross sections. It's a really neat way to get the elements in a material in cross section. And so when we look at calcium, we can look at 3 months and 6 months in the meris and the carapace. And we see that although calcium is increasing over time, there's actually no differences between treatments. And this was the same for magnesium. There was no significant differences between treatments, although I will say that and there was higher magnesium content in the low pH environment at 6 months. And so they were kind of using more magnesium, we think, in a low pH environment at 6 months, which is interesting. But how does this translate to material properties? You can maybe start to make predictions of that. But we used a nano indenter to be able to measure the hardness and the stiffness of the material. So here's an example of that. And that the nano indenter applies a known force to a material on the nano level scale, so on really, really small scales, to understand material property differences on really small scales. And we did this in the meris and the carapace, and actually not on the dactyl. And this was my undergraduate at the time, Summer Webb, and she's actually finishing her PhD at Scripps Institution of Oceanography now, which is pretty neat. And so with hardness and stiffness, again, hardness is the ability of a material to resist deformation, and stiffness is the ability, permanent deformation, and then stiffness is the ability of a material to resist temporary deformation. When you look at both of those, we didn't see any changes over time. We did see changes over time, but not between treatments as well. So there were no changes in material properties. And what I will also tell you is that we looked at the stress response of mantis shrimp to these treatments as well. So we looked at reactive oxygen species and proxies of those. Obviously, reactive ROS or reactive oxygen species are produced in times of stress. And so we looked at that. And we even did a small kind of side experiment where we dropped the pH to 7.3 and we saw no real stress response as measured by ROS. So that leads us to think that mantis shrimp are actually probably going to be pretty tolerant to future ocean conditions. And so maybe we can think about them as quote unquote a winner of ocean acidification or ocean warming. Like perhaps we're going to see a lot of mantis shrimp, at least of this group, this species in the future. Again, remember that they're intertidal species. And so they are experiencing a pretty wide variation in pH and temperature on a daily basis. But because they might be these winners in future climate change, perhaps they might be able to exploit less tolerant hard-shelled prey that are predicted to break more easily in future ocean conditions. And so we know that snails and clams and then kind of those kind of organisms are thought to have more, have thinner, weaker shells. And so mantis shrimp may be able to really exploit those populations. And then we can think about what that could mean for soft bodied prey too in the future, in places where mantis shrimp live. Are they going to then, be exploiting more soft bodied prey as well? They can have these larger ecosystem effects because they seem to be so tolerant to future conditions. So in a broader context, I think we learned, if we take all of this work together, I think we learned that specialized morphology can really broaden diet, like you see with mantis shrimp. And also one example we didn't talk about, but I think is an important one, are cichlid fishes, which a lot of you probably know, have highly specialized morphology for doing crazy things like consuming the scales off of the left side of another fish. But yet they have a more varied diet. And this is true also for Galapagos finches. And then we have the animals that are thought to have really narrow diets. And the question is, are those diets narrow, or do we just not know what they eat? Because we used this new technique and we kind of looked at mantis shrimp in a new way to understand what they're eating. Perhaps these animals that are thought to be specialists perhaps also have varied diets, and we just haven't looked at them in the right way yet. I think that mantis shrimp predators may also be really important trophic links between macroinvertebrates in the intertidal and the larger coral reef. So we know now that mantis shrimp consume a wide diversity of other prey in the ecosystem, but they're also consumed by many predators themselves. So they might be really important links in the coral reef food web. And so we think back to our original questions. We know that feeding specialization connects mantis shrimp to a wide diversity of organisms in the food web. And we also know that mantis shrimp are tolerant to future ocean conditions, which may impact the abundances of, and distributions of prey in the future. And so now that we kind of understand this, we've learned a couple main ideas that are guiding my work now. And that's that morphology and behavior can inform broad theory. Trophic dynamics of cryptic fauna might actually be important drivers of ecosystem function. And shifts in feeding abilities and trophic dynamics can be happening with climate change as well. And so particularly, I'm interested in looking at the trophic dynamics and environment questions. And so mantis shrimp are one of, you know, they live in these tiny little holes in a coral reef, but of course there are many tiny holes in a coral reef and there are a bunch of different organisms living in them. And we really don't know a lot of what they're doing. There are estimates that really only 10% of the coral reef biodiversity has been classified. So I, for kind of my last part of my time at Scripps, I worked with engineers and ecologists to, the engineers really built this robot, but we all worked on it together. But we were trying to build a robot that would be able, that would allow us to access these cryptic environments in a coral reef. So these tiny holes in a reef, we want to be able to really get into that to see what is in that environment. What is the environment like? What are these animals doing? And so this is the first prototype of that. And basically it's like if you turn your sock inside out and you turn a really, really long inside out sock inside out throughout the reef, that's what this is doing. And we were able to put a GoPro on the end of it. Obviously this needs to be scaled to be much smaller, but this was the first prototype. And I also I went to Maui and I stuck a selfie stick in a bunch of different holes in the coral reef, and also a Durafet, which was attached to a sea fox. So we basically extended a Durafet pH sensor out from a sea fox and so that we could put it into the reef. And so we can start to get a little bit of an idea of who's living inside a coral reef and what the environment is like. So that we can start to figure out what roles they play. What are they eating? What is the trophic ecology like inside the coral reef as well? And then to understand this question of shifts in feeding ability and trophic dynamics with climate change, I've started to work in a system that is very familiar to all of you, I'm sure. I've started to look at the kelp forest urchin dynamics from the perspective of the urchin. And so, and to understand how the Aristotle's lantern and feeding efficiency with Aristotle's lantern in the urchin is going to change with climate change. So how will urchins respond to future ocean conditions? There's of course been a lot of really neat work done on this in the past to understand to know how resilient urchins are going to be to future climate change. But what we don't know so much is about how the morphology and the material properties of the of Aristotle's lantern, which is really good, obviously at chomping at kelp, but also scraping, how that might change with future conditions. To understand a little bit of that in the present, with my old undergrad at the time, Summer Webb, we looked at how feeding efficiency can change with food abundance. And so there was this hypothesis in the literature that morphology of the Aristotle's lantern changes with food abundance, and that makes urchins more efficient at scraping when they're living in an urchin barren or at consuming kelp when they're in a kelp forest. And we actually found out that that's not really the case, that mantis shrimp, or that urchins just seem like they're more efficient when they're starved because they're hungry, and they're just eating more because they're hungry. So I want to look at this further and understand how these urchin, how the urchin kelp forest dynamic from the perspective of the urchin might change with future climate change. And this last project is one that's just getting started, one that I'm really excited about. It just got my first little bit of funding to look at it, and it is in collaboration with Brian Gaylord at the Bodega Marine Lab, which is so exciting. And so we are going to start looking at how estuary species, particularly this invasive clam and these compared to these two native clams, how they cope with large fluctuations in pH and temperature that you see in the bay, and how these organisms can help predict adaptations to future conditions. And so we're particularly going to look at how variation in material properties and mechanical properties of the shell change through change in the bay. And because, as you all know, in the Bay Delta, there's a wide range of pH and temperatures. This was just, you can see on the map here from the buoys around the bay. These are values taken just yesterday, but it's pretty illustrative of the kind of variation you see in the bay. And so how are these animals able to cope with these wide fluctuations in pH and temperature? And how can that help us predict how other organisms in the ocean are gonna respond as well? So really excited to work on this project and to be able to see you all at the Dega when I'm there working on this, when we finally are able to, you know, get back in the lab. So again, all of these questions I think really illustrate this broader context of my work that I've been really excited to share with you all. So thank you for having me again. And I don't know if there's time for questions, but I hope so. Thank you.
Thank you, Maya. I don't know if you can see me or hear me. Can you?
Can.
Perfect. So we have two questions on the chat. The first is by Aaron Inokawa, and he's asking if the temperature effects on water viscosity can influence the smashing or skewing capacity of the rims.
Oh man, that's a really good question, and actually one that I have not thought about too that is one that I've not thought about, but one that I know that Sheila Paddock and her team have been working on, trying to understand drag dynamics. And I don't think they've looked at temperature effects, but they do have a much better understanding of drag on both spearing and smashing appendages. Pretty sure they haven't looked at temperature, actually. It's a really great question. And they, but they have looked at drag dynamics, and there's like a really neat model that they've built. But basically, my guess is that unless you have really drastic change in temperature, you're not gonna see a huge impact of water viscosity because these animals are pretty large, although, you know, the small ones, maybe that's different. So I have to think about it a little bit more. Also, I'm not sure how much it matters because temperature doesn't vary too drastically where they live, although I say that cautiously. Because you can see that, of course, if you have like a rain event in the intertidal, it's going to be colder. So yeah, that's a good one. I don't have the best answer for that one.
Moving to the next, because we are running out of time. Mm-hmm. And the next question is from Stephen Morgan. And how will you test whether spearers outcompete smashers for soft body prey in the field as well as the lab?
Yeah, great question. I think the place to start is the lab, and I think you can put them together and just hope they don't beat each other up, but you know, give them their own cavities at least to start. And I think just kind of monitoring the, or you know, kind of taking data on the number of successful prey captures in a spear versus smasher when they're together. And you know, because I don't think they're directly competing. I think they're indirectly competing. Again, this is all pretty unknown. I think that the stable isotopes provided like a really great first set of observations. But we don't know yet. And I think the field would be really challenging because they are so small. I think ideally you would observe them on snorkel for many, many hours, but they're so small. So perhaps you can set up one thing you can do with mantis jumpers is really neat is you can have them recruit to artificial burrows. So that's probably the way to do this is put out a bunch of artificial burrows that they would recruit to, and then you could observe them that way more easily. And I think, yes, it would just be many hours under the water trying to figure out what they eat. They spend a lot of time feeding as far as we know. So I think that you could do it from just hours of observations if you're able to use artificial burrows to get them in the same place.
And I think it's 2 o'clock already. We can wrap up here. This was an awesome talk. Thank you, Maya.
Thank
you, everyone, for attending. And see you next week.
Thank you all. Bye.